So in this series that we've been doing, What's So Special About Jesus, we're getting to the meat of it now. Now we're getting into the what Jesus did and why. And we're going to really get into the details of that in the next couple of weeks as we wrap up the series. But today we're going to talk really about that Jesus came as part of the greatest rescue story ever told. And so as we kind of kick that off, I want to ask you, have you ever had a situation that was just so embarrassing that you kind of wanted the ground to open up and swallow you right then and there? Have you ever had that happen? I'll tell you, I've got some really good stories. Pretty much my whole life was like that. And probably one of the most embarrassing things happened when I was doing breakout with the youth here, but I'm not going to tell you that story today. I'll save that for another day. But I will tell you that I played basketball. You guys know I'm an athlete. Growing up, I was athletic, and I played softball, and I was pretty good at softball. I'm terrible at basketball, but it took me an embarrassing moment to realize that. And so, I view myself as a all-around athlete. So I tried out for the basketball team when I was in ninth grade. And I have to tell you, I lived in South Carolina, and it was a kind of a reversal of what we're used to. I was in the great minority of white people in an African-American church. It was our African-American school. It was 90% black. And that was different than what I was used to. But I tried out for the basketball team, and I made the basketball team, shocker. I never got to play. I hardly ever got to play, but the team was really, really good. And so we were in the championship game, and it got to the end of the game, and there was just less than a minute left, and we were tied, and they had the ball, and the coach said, "White girl," that's what they called me, "white girl, get in." And they did that because I was a terrible basketball player, but I was scrappy, and I was good at stealing the ball. Because I didn't know any better. So I didn't know about fouls and things. I just was good at stealing the ball. So she says, white girl, get in and get the ball. So sure enough, I jumped in and I started being scrappy. And we got under their basket and they were getting ready to shoot. And I slapped the ball away and I grabbed the ball and stole the ball. And the reason I wasn't a good basketball player is because it goes too fast for me, and I can't make decisions quick enough. But all of a sudden, all these people like whoosh, surrounded me, and I looked up and saw the basket. Whoosh, nothing but net in the wrong basket for the wrong team. I scored 2 points, and the buzzer sounded, and we lost by 2 points. And I'm standing in the middle of a gymnasium that is packed with people. And boy, did I want that floor to open up and swallow me. It was so embarrassing. I thought I was going to die. I thought they were going to kill me. And my friend Lucretia, I mean, it was bad. My friend Lucretia, who was one of the most popular girls in the school and the best basketball player, hands down, boys and girls, came over to me, walked over to me, put her arm around her and said, "Come on, white girl, let's go get some pizza." And I was redeemed because what she said, she rescued me. She rescued me from social death, I think, and possibly physical death. She rescued me, and everything was okay, and I was able to survive the rest of that ninth grade year. That's a powerful thing when somebody steps between you and ridicule or harm. I don't know about you. Imagine yourself in a situation where everybody is staring at you and your weakness and your flaws and maybe your transgressions are completely exposed. And you know, they talk about scientists or psychologists say that everybody has some version of the naked dream where you wake up or you dream that you're naked in front of everyone. Imagine if that really happened to you and you were not only physically naked, but from the inside out, everybody saw the ugliness on the inside too. And they were totally against you and maybe wanted to kill you. Can you imagine how you would feel if someone stepped in and rescued you? We're going to read a story like that this morning because that's really what Jesus does for all of us and did for all of us. And so we're going to read a story about this morning of Jesus stepping in to rescue a woman, literally stepping between her and death. And it's a great kind of a metaphor, little story within the big story of a rescue, a little rescue story within the big rescue story. And it really tells us, gives us a hint of exactly what Jesus did for all of us a little bit later with the cross. So we're going to read this. This is in John's Gospel. Again, a story you probably know, so open your minds to something new, maybe. Let God try to do something new with you this morning. This is in John 8, and it's verses 2 through 11. Hear these words. At dawn, that's talking about Jesus, at dawn, Jesus appeared again in the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery, and they set her before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and he said to them, "Let any of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Holy God, this morning, we ask that you would allow us to hear what you want us to hear, and only that, that you would give us hearts that will receive it, and then give us the boldness, give us the courage to respond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's make sure we understand what's happening in this scene. This is a sting operation. It's a setup. They bring this woman before Jesus, and they say, okay, the law of Moses, which is in Leviticus or the Ten Commandments, the law of Moses says somebody who commits adultery, that's in the top 10, and I'm gonna trust that you guys know what adultery is. If you don't, ask your mom. She'll explain it to you. But that's one of the top 10. If you commit adultery, you're supposed to be stoned. And I have to say, actually in the law, it says the adulterer and the adulteress should be stoned together. So my question in reading this is, where's the man? Because there had to be two. But anyway, that's a whole different thing. But anyway, so they bring this woman, and they stand her in front of Jesus, and they say, the law says that somebody who commits adultery like this should be stoned to death. Now think that through for a minute. We're going to throw rocks at this person until she dies. Ouch. Do you know that that's actually still practiced in some countries? Particularly some of the Muslim countries, they still practice that, stoning people for adultery and for other transgressions. So anyway, so now they ask Jesus, what should we do? Now this is Jesus who's been preaching forgiveness and talking about love, and so that puts Jesus in a lose-lose situation. Because if Jesus says, oh no, we're not going to stone her, and he doesn't obey what they call the Mosaic law, the law that came through Moses, then he's going to lose his credibility with the Jews, and they're going to go, okay, he's not really faithful to God because he's not keeping God's commands. So all the Jews would have turned on him if he said, oh, don't stone her. But then if he said, okay, yes, we're going to keep the law, let's go ahead and stone her, not only is that going to discredit his grace and his love that he's been practicing, but in Roman rule, in Roman law, see, they were occupied by Rome. In Roman law, nobody was allowed to execute another person except the Roman government. This is why later on they had to take Jesus to Pontius Pilate, to the Roman governor, because the Jews did not have the authority to kill somebody, to execute someone. So if he said, okay, let's follow the Mosaic law and let's stone her, then he could have been arrested by the Roman government. So it's a lose-lose situation for Jesus, and they were trying to trap him. And see, if we had read chapter 7 prior to this, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the leaders of the temple, were very upset with Jesus. He was very threatening to their authority and their position, and they had at that point said, we got to get rid of this guy, maybe even kill him if necessary. So they were trying to trap him. So Jesus is stuck in this situation where, you know, if he goes one way, then he alienates the Jews. If he goes the other way, then he could get arrested by the Romans. And he's kind of stuck. Let's also, before we go on and talk about what Jesus did and how he reacted, let's make sure we understand what this woman was going through. I want you to imagine yourself as this woman. We're told that she was caught in the act of adultery. So this is a G-rated version of this picture, I think, because my guess is that this woman was dragged, she was caught in the act. So my guess is that she probably did not have any clothes on, or maybe a blanket or some sort of a cloak at best. So she was probably physically exposed, but also she's in the court of the temple, which is, imagine the pig picking. All the crowd of Sandbridge and everybody at Sandbridge was there. That's how the court of the temple was. That was the open public part of the temple, and it was always packed. So she's brought before this crowd completely exposed, possibly physically, but definitely emotionally. And she's guilty. They caught her in the act. She's guilty. Imagine how she must have been feeling. There's probably a part of her that wanted to die, and yet she's also facing these people standing there angry at her, holding rocks to throw at her. She must have been terrified, hopeless. Can you just get your mind around that for a minute, how she must have felt? And Jesus did something really crazy. Jesus, rather than answer their question, kneels down and starts writing something on the ground. And we don't know what he wrote. Some people feel like he wrote maybe the Ten Commandments or wrote some of the law down. Some people think that he was writing down the sins of all the people holding rocks, which is possible. We don't really know. But pay attention to what he accomplished by doing that. Because they all started looking at this woman. They're all staring at this woman. They're all looking down on this woman. And all of a sudden, he took the spotlight off the woman and onto himself, writing in the sand or on the ground. And if you think about what that means, he changed the spotlight, but in changing the spotlight and taking the attention off of her, he changed their perspective. See, they are looking down on her, because they could, because she was guilty. And then all of a sudden, now they're looking at Jesus. And let me tell you, my friends, you cannot look at Jesus and feel superior. Instead of looking and feeling superior by looking at this woman's sin, now they're looking at Jesus, the one and only person who had no sin, a whole different perspective. I remember driving not too long ago. I was in traffic, and there was a car in front of me, and I loved the bumper sticker. Was so funny. It said, "I may be slow, but I'm ahead of you." Isn't that how we all kind of look at our own sin? We all go, I may have made a mistake, or I may not be so great, but I'm better than that person. And that's what they're doing. And all of us build ourselves up by looking down at other people. We compare ourselves. And yes, sometimes we look at somebody who's prettier or skinnier or whatever, and we feel bad about ourselves. But when it comes to sin, a lot of times we're, oh, that wasn't that bad. I'm not near as bad as that person. That person's so much worse. None of us can do that with Jesus. See, if the focus comes off of the woman and onto Jesus, all of a sudden, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, as Paul tells us in Romans. All of us, everybody, nobody has measured up. And so in comparison to Jesus, now they look a little bit different. And so then Jesus says, okay, look at me. Anybody that can compare to me, throw a rock. Go ahead. Nope. And that's what started to happen. Compared to Jesus, they recognize that they don't measure up. He's the only person who has the right to throw a rock there. And so they start dropping their rocks and walking away. And I love the fact that the older people went first. You know why? We had more time. More time to do bad things. More time to mess up. See, here's the thing. Revelation tells us that the church is the bride of Christ. And Jesus called the Jewish people of that time an adulterous generation. My friends, we are also an adulterous generation. Because if we are the bride of Christ, which means Christ is number one. Lord God is the Lord of our lives, and he comes first, and we live in alignment with him, and that's the primary relationship in our lives. Anytime any of us chooses something else and someone else to become the primary relationship or the primary focus of our lives, we are also committing adultery. That's idolatry. That's putting something else in God's place. It could be a relationship. It could be your sexuality and your identity. It could be your money, your power. It could even be your church. Anytime that we put something else between ourselves and God being the Lord of our lives, we are just as guilty as that woman. See, sin is sin is sin is sin, and it all is ugly and gross and separates us from God, all of it. And so we cannot look at other people and go, I'm okay, I'm ahead of that person. We need to look at Jesus and go, ooh, I cannot throw a stone because I am just as guilty. That's what Jesus did for this woman. He literally got between this woman and death. She was going to be stoned to death. And he stood in between them and took the focus instead on himself and saved her from death. I love the very best part of the story, though, I think is the next part, where he says to the woman, where's your condemners? Who's condemning you? She goes, no one. And Jesus says, neither do I. Neither do I. Wow, what a part of the gospel that we forget sometimes, don't we? Don't we forget that part of the gospel? John 3:16, that everybody knows by heart. For God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And we want to stop there. But the next verse is equally as important. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. Jesus chose, he was the only one that could throw a rock, and he chose not to condemn this woman, not to condemn her. Instead, he said, you know what? Go and leave your life of sin. Go and live differently. And I don't know in this situation whether she was on the ground or standing in front of him or what happened. I don't know if he touched her physically like he did with the leper or Jairus' daughter and said, get up. I don't know. But I think he touched her life in some way, much by that, like the woman at the well that we talked about. He touched her life in some way. So he was able to say to her, you know what? You're alive today. But now you have, because you've encountered me, you have the ability and the power to go and live differently. That is the great news of the gospel. That is the great news of the resurrection. My friends, we don't have to wait until we die to be in the presence of Christ. The presence of Christ, the power of Christ is here for us now. And in that power, we can go and live the resurrection, which means we can be transformed, and the power and the presence of Jesus in us helps us to live a different way. I remember teenagers used to say, well, I'm doing that because I just can't help it. Yes, you can, because Jesus lives in you. The power of Jesus lives in you, and that gives you the power and me the power to go live differently. And that's what he's saying to this woman. I am offering you grace. I'm offering you new life. I am rescuing you from death. But more importantly, I'm rescuing you from sin. I'm rescuing you from a life that would keep you separated from God. Instead, go and live a different life. And in that life, in the presence of God, living in the will of God, according to Jesus' example and through Jesus' power, there is fullness of life there. There is joy there. That's what Jesus is offering. That's the rescue here. It's not just from physical death. It's from sin. Paul tells us in Romans 5:8, and we're going to say the words. Well, we don't say it in the modern service, but if we did the traditional one, we say, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. My friends, all of us have gunk in our lives. All of us have things that separate us from God. All of us standing next to Jesus are not pretty. And yet, while we were sinners, Christ died for us. He knows our sins. He knows our shame. He knows our adultery. He knows our idolatry. And he chose not to condemn us, but to die for us so that we could be saved from eternal death, but more importantly, so that we could be saved from the muck of the sin in our own lives. This rescue story is not just about eternity. It's about the here and now. Because of Jesus, we have the power to go and live some differently. I want to challenge you this morning. If the presence of Christ in your life has not changed your life, have you really been rescued? Because I don't believe you can truly be rescued without being transformed and being changed. Jesus died for you and for me to rescue us from death, but more importantly, to rescue us from sin so that we could have the fullness of life. I want to show you something, and it's been around forever. It's a depiction of the gospel story, of the rescue mission that I saw probably 20 years ago at a youth rally, and it's powerful. It might not be the music that some of you love. It's by a group called Lifehouse, and it's called Everything. And some of you might not like the music, but pay attention to the story and watch the story unfold. Go ahead and play that.
Thank you.
Jesus came to stand between us and anything that would separate us from the fullness of God, us in death, us in sin. We can't get there by ourselves, but Jesus did it for us. I don't know what you might be carrying with you today that might be separating you from the fullness of life that God offers for you today. But as we celebrate communion this morning, I want you to think about what the bread and the juice means. Jesus, God, loved you so much that Jesus was willing to give his own body and blood to get between you and death, to get between you and whatever's separating you from God. Recognize that. Whatever that gunk is in your life, come and leave it up here. If you need to kneel at the altar, at the communion rail, do that. Leave it up here. And then take the body and blood and receive the power and presence of Christ so that you can go and live differently in the fullness of the life that Jesus offers to you. Let's pray. Holy God, we just thank you so much that you loved us so much, that you sent your Son to love us and to literally die for us, to stand between us and death, and not to condemn us, but to give us a transformation, the power to live in relationship with you. We thank you and praise you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.